Eleonor of Habsburg was the prototype of the ideal Renaissance princess, born and raised to serve her family in any given situation, even if that went against her personal desires. From a young age, she was considered by her relatives as a valuable asset to the Habsburg dynasty, and throughout her life, she always behaved as a devoted and obedient daughter, sister, and wife, with great pride and without any complaints. Many times in her life, Eleonor was forced to do as she was told, sometimes making huge personal sacrifices. But beyond being just a piece in the political chess game, Eleonor was also a queen, twice, and a refined and educated woman who had a knowledge of Europe much deeper than other royal women of her time. From Flanders, where Eleonor was born and raised, to the Iberian Peninsula that she discovered in her youth and retired in the old age, and France, where Eleonor was queen for 17 years, surrounded by a court where she was seen as the sister of the enemy. So on this video, I'm gonna try to find out how did Eleonor become Queen of France, as well as a personal dream she cherished throughout her reign there. Before we start, don't forget to like and subscribe. Eleonor was born in Brussels in 1498. She was the first child of the Archdukes of Austria, Philip of Habsburg, known as Philip the Handsome, and Joanna of Castile, known as Joanna the Mad. 2 years later, her brother, the future Charles V, was born in the city of Ghent. For political reasons, Eleonor and her siblings were born and raised in different parts of Europe. Eleonor, Charles, Isabella, and Mary were born and educated in Flanders, while Fernando and Catherine were born in Spain. This was because in 1500, Joanna became the heir to the Spanish crown, which made her and her husband travel to the peninsula twice before settling there for their brief reign. A situation that brought some tension between Philip and the Catholic kings, Joanna's parents, that seemed to dislike him because of his extreme ambition and his close proximity to the French. Philip died unexpectedly in 1506, leaving his wife pregnant with Catherine and in a spiraling state of depression. Since November of 1503, it was of public knowledge that Joanna suffered from some kind of mental health issue after she spent several hours of the night outside in the cold and refusing to leave. After the death of her husband, her situation became increasingly worse, which led to her imprisonment in Tordesillas, where she lived for almost half a century, forgotten by most. Because of the long absence of their parents, Eleonor and her northern siblings were raised and educated by their aunt, Margaret of Austria, in Malines, some miles outside of Brussels, in the same court where Anne Boleyn lived some years later. Margaret of Austria was an extraordinary ruler with a sharp political ability and an above-the-average level of culture and education. Her court was famous for its brilliancy and refinement, as well as a center of the arts, literature, and humanism of the Renaissance of the North. In her court, Margaret lived surrounded by artists, poets, musicians, and philosophers. In an inventory of 1524, it's possible to know that Margaret's library had 379 books, a considerable number of titles for the time. Between classical authors like Virgil, Seneca, and Livy, she also possessed works by Froissart, Petrarch, St. Augustine, and Christine de Pizan. Margaret also owned what is possibly the most famous illuminated manuscripts of the Middle Ages, the Hours of the Duc de Berry, made in the beginning of the 15th century. On the walls of her palace hang paintings like the portrait of the Arnolfini couple, a jewel of Flemish painting produced by Van Eyck, and other portraits of her family and paintings by renowned artists of her time. It's in this environment that Eleonor and her brother and sisters grew up, with Margaret as a model, especially for the girls, transmitting them a strong state sense, pity, and dignity. These are the teachings that allowed Eleonor to overcome the many hardships in her life in a gracious and dignified way. Many years later, a Spanish noble noted that she had no more malice than a dove. Always a determined woman, Eleonor was able to keep her kindness and candor even in the worst of times, showing great resilience and authority. Since her childhood, Eleonor had many marriage projects associated with her. After all, she was the most valuable of her sisters as she was the eldest one. This comes as no surprise since marital strategies were the base of the international politics of the Habsburg dynasty. Curiously, one of the first marriage projects for Eleonor was with Francis of Valois, the future Francis I of France, in 1505. That same year, another proposal arrived from Portugal, a double marriage. Eleonor would marry John, heir to the Portuguese throne, and his sister, the Infanta Isabel, would marry Charles V. Margaret of Austria approved this union and recommended in a letter to her father, the Emperor Maximilian I, at that point the chief of the Habsburg dynasty. In her letter, Margaret pointed the benefits of a closer connection to Portugal, since the Portuguese royal family was already related and allies to the Habsburgs, as well as the prosperity of that kingdom. As an intelligent politician she was, Margaret ends the letter reminding that it was important not to forget that other alliances were available, and that Maximilian still had Leonor's sisters at his disposal. This marriage project was put aside and others were formulated, until the death of Fernando the Catholic, which led to a new distribution of powers in the Iberian Peninsula. Charles V, as the heir to the Spanish crown, traveled with his sister Leonor to the peninsula, arriving there in September of 1517 aboard a Flemish fleet, after days of violent storms and rough seas. For the first time, the two Burgundian siblings were in their mother's homeland. Everything was strange and new to them, from the music and costumes to the language and culture. In November, Leonor and Charles visited their mother in Tordesillas, where she was incarcerated since 1509. They haven't seen their mother in more than a decade, and Juana had some difficulty recognizing her own children. Before Charles and Leonor set sail to Spain, King Manuel of Portugal, the father of the future husband of Leonor, secretly arranged to take his son's place and marry his future daughter-in-law. Charles agreed, and Leonor, in her early 20s, married the widower king of almost 50, becoming the new queen of Portugal. Leonor arrived in her new kingdom in the fall of 1518, but her reign there was short-lived, as her husband Manuel died in December of 1521, leaving Leonor as a young widow in a kingdom where she was still seen as a stranger and a foreigner. Although Leonor's passage through Portugal was brief, she was bound to it for the rest of her life. From her union with a Portuguese king, two children were born, Charles, that died shortly after his birth, and Maria, born some months before her father's death in 1521. According to her marriage contract with King Manuel, Leonor, in case of ever becoming a widow, could choose to stay in Portugal or return to Spain. And if she chose to go back to Castile, she had the right to take her offspring with King Manuel with her. More than that, she didn't even need to ask the present King of Portugal for permission. She was free to do as she desired and leave whenever she wanted. Immediately after the death of her husband, Leonor was struck by grief, as she truly seemed to enjoy the company of her husband, who always treated her with great respect and kindness. Leonor and her stepdaughter Isabel were very close and withdrawn together from the palace to a feminine convent, where they lived for some time, sharing the strict and pious lifestyle of the nuns. But the issue of Leonor's future became unavoidable. As a good soldier, she waited for instructions from her brother Charles, but the situation was too complex for an immediate resolution. The Portuguese and the Spanish court started negotiations for a possible marriage between Leonor and her 19-year-old stepson, John, the new king of Portugal. The negotiations lasted for a long time but didn't reach any agreement. Finally, in 1523, Leonor was called by her brother to Castile, becoming once again available to the marital politics of her family. But it's at this point that Leonor's drama really starts. By completely ignoring the marriage contract of his father, John III refused to let Maria, the only surviving child of Leonor and her husband, depart with her mother to Castile, a decision supported by the Portuguese court. It was considered inappropriate for a Portuguese princess to be raised in a foreign court, where her best interests would be neglected, not to mention the financial complexities that a situation like that would bring. The final point was that no Portuguese princess would ever leave her kingdom without the security of a marriage contract. Leonor left Portugal and her daughter, believing the situation was only temporarily. Leonor could still return to Portugal in order to marry John III, and she still believed that, with the pressure exerted by her brother, the King of Portugal could let Maria join her in Spain. Unfortunately for Leonor, none of these options ever became a reality. On the 24th of February of 1525, the armies of Charles V crushed the armies of Francis I, King of France, in the Italian city of Pavia. To the French, the disaster of Pavia is only compared to the defeats of Crécy and Azincourt in the Hundred Years' War. Even worse, the French King Francis was captured and made a prisoner of Charles V in Madrid. The situation was tense, and Charles V made a long list of demands in return for France's freedom. Negotiations were long and complex. Charles demanded the return of the Duchy of Burgundy, lost to France in the end of the 15th century, the payment of all the debts that Francis owed him, and the abandonment of all the French pretensions to Milan, Naples, and Genoa. To seal these negotiations, Francis would marry Leonor and later his eldest son, the Dauphin, with Maria, Leonor's daughter. For the first time, and facing a complex political situation, Leonor was consulted about her future. Did she wish to become Queen of France, or marry with Charles de Bourbon, a dissident Duke of Francis with whom she was promised in marriage at this time. Leonor chose Francis for two particular reasons. This marriage was fundamental for the re-establishment of peace between the Habsburgs and the Valois in a time where Europe was under the threat of the Ottoman Empire, and because she would be reunited with her daughter Maria when she married Francis' eldest son. Not only would this allow Leonor to have her daughter by her side in France, Maria would also be given a proper marriage and the title of future Queen of France. All the terms were agreed between Charles V and Francis I in the Treaty of Madrid. One of the articles stipulated that the two sons of Francis would be sent to Spain in exchange for the freedom of the French king, as a security measure for Charles V, who didn't trust Francis. In fact, these two men saw each other as their greatest enemy until the end of their lives. On the 17th of February, 1526, Leonor met Francis for the first time in the company of her brother. After that moment, Leonor started signing her letters to Francis as his humble and obedient wife. Francis I left for France and Leonor awaited her departure there, but as soon as he was free, Francis started giving signs that he was going to ignore the deal he made with Charles, even if his sons, Francis and Henry, only 8 and 7 years old, were under Spanish control. Charles ordered for the French princes to be separated from their French entourage, and their imprisonment made more severe. Although Leonor was still waiting to join her husband in her new kingdom, which was a somewhat humiliating position, she pitied the two children and for several times pleaded to her brother and his new wife, Isabel of Portugal, for the captivity of the two boys to be softened. The political relationship between Charles and Francis was growing ever more convoluted by the day, and Leonor was caught in the middle of it, with her marriage with the French king now in suspense and with an uncertain future. The relations between Spain and France were worse than ever. War was again on the horizon, and even the King of England was now involved, taking Francis' side. Finally, the two sides realized that the only realistic way out of this deadlock was to make peace, a process that had already started in secrecy between the two strong women of each side. In the fall of 1528, Margaret of Austria, Charles' aunt, and Louisa of Savoy, Francis' mother, two experimented and shrewd politicians, started exchanging letters in order to finish this conflict, which was draining the two factions of money and lives. On August of 1529, in the city of Cambrai, the two women signed what became known as La Paz de las Damas, the Ladies' Peace. In the summer of 1530, Leonor was married by proxies with Francis, and his two sons were returned to France in exchange for an astronomical ransom paid by the French, the equivalent of a year of income for that kingdom. At last, and after years of negotiations and political setbacks, Leonor and her stepsons arrived in France. In her new kingdom, Leonor was seen as an emblem of peace, personified by the image of the queen as the savior of the French princes from their Spanish prison. Francis and Leonor headed to Paris, passing through the most important cities on their way there, where the new queen was received with festivities, hunts, and parties. On the spring of 1531, Leonor was crowned Queen of France in the Abbey of Saint-Denis, in the presence of the most important noble families in the kingdom. This ceremony, one of the many created by the French monarchy since the Middle Ages, as an instrument of proximity to the French people, was purely symbolical and didn't endow Leonor with any real power. During her reign in France, Leonor lived a relatively isolated life from court. Francis always shown her some affection for her good qualities as a queen and also her efforts to ease his son's captivity in Spain, but Francis didn't give her much space to influence him politically or have any close proximity. Above all, Leonor was a symbolic queen, who had little power over her husband, a notorious womanizer. In fact, during Leonor's official entry in the city of Paris, the king assisted a ceremony from a balcony accompanied by his mistress, Anne de Pisseleu, the Duchess of Etampes. Although Leonor didn't reach the power of other contemporary queen lovers, like Catherine of Medici in France, or, later, her younger sister Catherine in Portugal, Leonor did manage to have some modest power on international French politics, based on her position as the sister of the Holy Roman Emperor. Once again, the relationships between Spain and France were tense, and Charles and Francis were inclined to war. Unexpectedly, it was Leonor one of the main agents for peace, confirmed by the constant presence of foreign ambassadors next to the queen, a peace desired by most kingdoms in Europe and also the Pope, in a moment of rise of Protestantism. Leonor, thanks to her exquisite education in Flanders and her travels through Europe, also had a strong influence in the art and culture of the French Renaissance. For centuries, this influence went unnoticed by historians and seen as pale when compared with the patronage of the arts of her husband and the literary court of his sister, Marguerite d'Angoulême, which lived surrounded by poets and philosophers. But it's impossible to ignore the cultural actions of Eleonor, especially in literature and music. Unlike Francis, which, although a great admirer and connoisseur of painting, architecture, and poetry, had a modest musical education, Eleonor received with her siblings in Malines a refined education in music, and she played several instruments like the clavichord or lute. Thanks to her patronage, several musicians and composers settled in the French court, enriching its cultural landscape. Written sources point that the queen dressed in the Spanish style, and Eleonor also had a strong influence in fashion. During her reign in France, Spanish fashion was on the rise and becoming dominant in Europe, and Eleonor helped introduce the new style in France and use it to signal her own personal identity and her blood ties to Habsburg Spain. Much before Catherine of Medici, famous as an avid collector of portraits, Eleonor already patronized this art form, commissioning paintings to artists like Corneille de Lyon, Léonard Limousin, and Antoine Trouvéon. Eleonor even entrusted Trouvéon to travel to the Portuguese court in order to send her updated portraits of her daughter Maria. In 1542, Eleonor accused the reception of a portrait of Maria, quite possibly the drawing of the Infanta today kept in the collections of the Musée de Chantilly near Paris. Eleonor wrote to her daughter saying how happy she was with the portrait, even though her true wish was to see Maria with her own eyes. During her reign in France, one project was always on Leonor's mind, the marriage of her daughter with the Dauphin and her move to France. But once again, Leonor's plans were not always aligned with international politics, and the negotiations came and went without any result, until the unexpected death of the Dauphin in 1536 brought an end to Leonor's expectations. Unlike the Dauphin, with whom Leonor had a close relationship, his brother Henry, now the heir to the French throne, didn't like her or anything that had to do with Spain, as he never forgot the years he spent there in captivity. Besides, Henry had recently married with Catherine of Medici, so a marriage between him and Maria was out of question. Eleonor then thought about Charles, the third child of Francis I, who was particularly interested in the fabulous dowry of the Portuguese princess, but he too died in 1545. Eleonor had to settle for the situation, for now. The reign of Eleonor ended in 1547 with the death of her husband Francis I. The new king, Henry II, although never close to her, informed her that, if she desired, she could remain in France with all her possessions and rights. Without her royal husband, Eleonor was now a powerless widow in France, a kingdom where she had little connections, so she decided to leave the following year. She first lived in the Lower Countries in the shadow of her brother, Charles V. For 8 years, Eleonor, Charles, and their sister Mary, the widow queen of Hungary, lived once again and just like their childhood, together in the north of Europe. Eleonor still hadn't given up from her daughter and saw an opportunity in her nephew, Philip of Spain, recently widowed from his first marriage. The Portuguese and the Spanish court were negotiating the marriage between Philip and Maria. Eleonor avidly supported the match, and in 1552 Maria was already being treated as the Princess of the Asturias, the title that Philip had at that time. But once more, politics spoke louder, and Charles V commanded his son to marry Mary Tudor, who had recently been made Queen of England. The narrative created was that the Portuguese Infanta was sacrificing her happiness to save England's soul. The truth is that John III had no interest in marrying his sister, as that would mean a great loss of money for his kingdom through her dowry. In 1555, and after decades of being in power, Charles V decided to retire to Spain and spend the rest of his days in a monastery. His two sisters follow him there. One last time, Eleonor traveled to the peninsula. Time was running out, and she only had one goal in life now, to see her daughter again. Once in Spain, Eleonor made everything in her power to see her daughter, but she was facing the same walls and the same arguments as before. John III refused to let his sister cross the border, and even the city of Lisbon was against it, fearing that Maria wouldn't come back and remain in Spain with her mother. Finally, in 1558, after the death of King John III and years of negotiations, Mary made a public and solemn promise to return from Spain after the visit to her mother. In January of the same year, in the Spanish city of Badajoz, mother and daughter saw each other for the first time in 35 years. For 20 days, the portraits that Eleonor received from Maria became a real flesh and blood person, and Eleonor was able to see the face of her beloved daughter one last time. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you on the next video.